Good evening, friends. Today's anchor is Engineer Rajendra Pawar.
I think then we will have, we must continue with our Ferro Talk series. Welcome, Sharma sir.
Namaskar, sir.
You must have seen those video clips of the previous Ferro Talks.
Yeah.
So, what's your opinion, sir? We would like to know from you.
Nice. They are nice, and now we are on the way. And subsequently, actually, we can enlarge all of them.
Mm-hmm, right.
We can this thing and put some more technical reports, and then I think they will become very valuable records.
Yeah. The basic idea is to have more and more interaction about the technology and its advancement. So, can you have words on this?
I thought I will just tell you some background of this, how Ferrocement started in India and how the group proceeded. It was in 1969 when Professor J.S. Ramaswamy, who was the director of SCRC, went to Poland and also Russia. When he came back, he had many meetings with Dr. Valkas in Law Technical University. So he bought a lot of materials on ferrocement, but most of them was on roofing units and pipes. He also bought a lot of materials from literature from Russia. That was also on pressure pipes and also some other allied material. So he formed a group in SCRC. I was fortunate to join him. And then there were other people, well, Dr. V.P. Narayan Swami and G. Surakumar, he's in U.S. And Dr. Gopal Krishnan, he was with SCRC, now he's retired. So this was the group. And then we started working on it. So the first thing was to have a survey of the country and then know which are the pockets from where we can get sand, wire meshes, chemicals, and manpower. Then we started in the laboratory, and the first structure, or you can say sample, we tested was a 10 meter long stress ribbon installed in the laboratory and then tested with the help of bricks. And we had some strain measurements, we fixed some. But that was very preliminary. We just was to convince ourselves that we can do it. That subsequently we decided that when we start working in the laboratory, we must also start developing some small items for the public. So the first item was a bin, grain storage bin, because that was the period when a lot of wastage of grain was there. So we started grain storage bin and also water tank. Then somebody suggested, why not a manhole cover? So we started manhole cover also. So this went on. Then we were testing a lot of, samples or rather prototypes in the laboratory. And then we were convinced that yes, we can produce these things with the materials which we were available there. So it was up to 1972-73. We were struggling in the laboratory. Then Dr. Kaushik and Dr. Krikha, we convinced them to identify some of their PhD and M.Tech students to join us and then do work on ferrocement theoretical part and also practical parts. So they started. At the same time, Dr. Prakash Desai in Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, he started work. Another gentleman in IIT Kharagpur, he also started. So then we started one after the other, some items came. Then all of a sudden, we decided that by doing by hand is going to be very good for the general public, but we should try to commercialize it, commercial production of these items. Then we went for mechanized systems we started developing. 1974, our first patent was filed in India and then this was given to National Research Development Corporation, and then they issued 60 licenses to different people, and then these people in the field, they started production. So this was how the line broke, and then these things started coming in the market. Now, tanks which were produced in 1974-73, they are installed in Ghaziabad, Delhi, and all these areas, and they are still in very nice condition. In my own house, I have a roof which was done in 1973, and tanks which was done in 1972-71. They are all right, and so that convinced us that this will be durable material. Then another three tanks we did on the roof of fly ash building in Madras, our Madras campus. Those tanks are also very nice and still in working condition. So it gave us the confidence that yes, our products, what we are doing, going to do is going to be very nice as far as work is concerned. And cost price was also, we were on 1/3 of the cost of Syntex tanks at that time. So we push it. Then we convinced CPWD. The CPWD used these tanks on 10,000 liters and 15,000 liters on all their this transport bhavan, Yojana bhavan, and all these roofs. And a lot of work came, and a lot of contractors also worked here. Then we thought of training manpower. Then Government of India had a project which was giving money to certain polytechnics for training of the polytechnic teachers and also technicians. Mm-hmm. So we joined with the Institute of Engineering and Rural Technology. There was one Dr. Jain, father of our Jain, who is with us now. So then we organized a large number of training programs in Roorkee and also in Allahabad. So we trained polytechnic teachers and also a lot of technicians. So this manpower was available. Subsequently, Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, all these places, this went and they started doing it. Then we convinced UNICEF. UNICEF gave us a lot of projects and also a lot of money. So we did Andaman Nicobar, then Lakshadweep, then North Kachar district, Assam, Nagaland, Meghalaya, all these places we started projects for them. You will wonder, there was a place known as Maram Kulen. Maram Kulen is a place which is 40 kilometers away from the main road leading from Kohima to Manipur, Imphal. And we did a big project, and 160 people collected, invited from Northeast, diploma holders and also technicians, they were trained during that program. And we covered 10 villages and provided ferrocement tanks and roofing units and also rainwater harvesting system. So like this went on. And then we added many things after coming to Ghaziabad. Check dams were added. Then 69 itself, we developed a system for ferrocement waterproofing of old leaky roof. So the first was our Gautam Sarabhai, Vikram Sarabhai's elder brother. He was convinced, and then we did calico mix roof, large roof. Then we made some domes in BM Institute, large domes. They are still in working condition. And I can add, the most complicated structure which we did was a shank in Ghaziabad.
I have seen that. We have been at your home and you have shown that it's a very unique kind of thing.
It's a very complicated one. And then we developed the walling system and made a building in CBRI campus. This was for 10 stories. It was a lock-in type ferrocement panel. But unfortunately, the CBRI dismantled that building subsequently 4-5 years ago. And we could not made more observations, but we have about 25 years observations on that structure, and it was all right. So this I thought I will just add up. I'm now trying to salvage things from my old records and then try to pass it on to you, all of you.
Fine. That's very much, it will be a treasure for us actually, so that we can get the history basically known to us, and then how we have traveled so far, and we can decide how further we can march ahead. It's a very nice historical coverage by you, Sharmaji. Simultaneously, I think by this time we were all working individually, particularly in India. It was not institutionalized as such. I think the Ferrocement Society of India was established in 2008 in Pune. It is the first of its kind. Before that, some institutes like IIT Kharagpur, as you just mentioned, some engineering colleges in Kerala and even Chennai, they were doing some work. All of us are working in individual capacities. If we now institutionalize it, then the advancement of the Ferrocement technology can be in far better way. I will just give one latest good news to all of you. From the government of Maharashtra has recently issued a GR, government resolution, and accepted that under that National Water Mission, a ferrocement water tanks can be used or constructed by any contractor.
What we should do, the earlier sanctions, see, suppose water tanks and roofing units, manhole covers, rainwater harvesting system, this was all accepted by National Drinking Water Mission. And I was working as a project leader for that project. And they have been used all over the country by PHAGs. So we should actually try to dig out the records. Some reports and some this thing which we submitted to this thing. There are some booklets also. So then earlier, you know, there are many institutions. I don't know whether they are working now. Auravilli, there was a group.
I have seen that.
Matramandir. We have we did the panels for Matramandir with the Auravilli group. Mm-hmm. Then biogas, a lot of work was done there. And then there was another one boy, John Pulimud. He was in Cochin.
Yeah.
He was also doing very good work. This is 1980s, 82. So we should actually find out. Then our Dr. A.M. Pandey in Pune, is in Nagpur. He has done a very good job. So like that, we have many people who are just scattered here and there. We should collect all of them.
Yes. No, but see, with the background of your experiences, what we have experienced particularly in our state is since there is no BIS code yet issued by the authority, the BIS code, the state governments doesn't easily accept this technology for the design's purpose or giving sanctions to the designs. No, so that is the main hazard. So that's why this ferrocement technology should not be arrested in all the people's mind that it is only for some innovative designs. It is not for the common construction. So this kind of fear or the misconcept should not increase. So that's why we should go for our normal regular building construction in roadworks, in buildings, in water retaining structures, and any kind of things.
We have to convince people. You know, I and Dr. Our Vishnu Jofi, we did a big dome for Philips Pavilion in IITF long ago.
Okay,
both of us.
There is
a school, American Embassy School. It was about to come down. So myself, I and Vishnu both spent some time, and we have repaired the total with ferrocement, and it has completed now I think 28-30 years now, and it is perfectly in condition, very good condition.
Thank you, sir. I started ferrocement work when I was a professor in College of Engineering, Pune. I had run about 30 research projects for the students, for MA and BE students. And I got confidence that we can bring this material in market. That is why in 82, I left the job, started my own industry, and then started constructing newer and newer works. I had a main plan of using ferrocement as structural material. Up to this time, it was designed as RCC only within elastic limits, and that is why it could not be used for higher loads and strains. So I had used it in a different form as a structural material, and I have built a number of different types of structures. I have built a silo which is 25 feet diameter and 50 feet high. This silo, generally for construction of silos, we use slip formwork, but we did not use that. We used inner and outer walls of the silo as formwork made in ferrocement, cast in situ, and then concrete was poured in it. Or the other main structure, or a very unique structure that we have built, is a pipeline, a conduit, about 12-13 feet diameter conduit, which is diverting the Nala in Pune, and about 700 feet long. 700 feet long, and it is continuous. As the stream flows, that also flows in that same direction. Like that, a number of novel structures we have built. We have built, Dr. Purandare has helped us in our guided us in many things. We have built about 30,000 square feet of floor, fourth floor of a building, by using cast formwork. That means for slabs, you have used centering plates in ferro cement. Then for hollow beam, then we have used beams, columns in form of boxes, and about 30,000 square feet of a floor, fourth floor of a college was built under guidance of Dr. Chandra. Then also we have also built retaining walls, about 250 feet long and about 18 to 19 feet high. Then petrol tanks which were about 1200 meter cube capacity. So like that, many novel applications of ferrocement were developed. And they are used nowadays. Now this arch-fed dams has become so popular that it is used by even anybody in the field. Water vapor, right. I did it first for the room number 13 for college engineering. It was one of the projects of my students. And now when I did it for the college, it became very popular thing, and it is now used everywhere. Like that, I have got a small contribution for ferrocement.
Yes, it's not small. Everybody knows that you have given your total life for this technology, and we really appreciate that, and certainly we will are hopeful to guide us further. I think now we will have some experience from Gujarat, our one of the esteemed members, Mr. Udayan Soni.
Structures we have already constructed since last couple of years, almost right from 1988 onwards. And variety of structures we have constructed, many domes, dome structures up to 50 feet into in span, clear span of 50 feet, and some elevations of facade elevation of buildings we have created, and even many structures, other structural applications also we have done, like some of the arch lintels we have created from ferro cement, and even facade walls also we have created in many of our projects. So variety of structure, water tanks also we have constructed up to 20,000 liter water tanks, and many projects we did in last 88 from 88 onwards.
Can I ask you, have you found any difficulty particularly while designing these variety of structures?
Yeah, because when we started from 88, there was no that much details particularly for designs. So we were just going on thumb rule base and on experience what we were facing. Actually, it was our privilege that we were trained from Roorkee seminar, conducted by Sharma ji. It was organized by Sharma ji, and in 1984. I attended 84. No, sir.
There were two seminars. One was 84, another was 88.
Yeah, yeah. I was in 84 seminar.
Yeah. Yes, you were in 84.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that basic data just we tried and applied in our projects, no? What,
okay.
Whatever the we and then after during that execution work, no? Just we learn and we just carry on thumb rule basis and we applied like that.
Using the Ferrocement manuals, the handbooks, the design books are available now. Those are also available on our website of Ferrocement Society of India. Are they in use for the design purpose or some planning purpose?
It is very good detail. I when I came in 2019 also. At Nasik, no? I got so many other details also and books and references. So they are really worth enough to go on for execution, no? There is plenty of details in that. Yeah.
Yes, that is the very purpose of our this Ferro Talk. We must exchange the ideas, the documents and the literature available. Mm. And as like Mr. Sharma rightly said, that all the person we get to know, certainly it will be helpful for submitting to the IAS and getting the code approval as the earliest. Now go to directly Bangladesh, Mohammed Sadiq ji.
Actually, since 1980, in the Housing and Building Research Institute, so some people started working with this ferrocement.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, some people from that institute, they attended some programs in China as well as in AIT Bangkok. So first, they came to know regarding this UC technology. And they have started around 80s, they have started working with ferrocement in a small scale. Especially at one time, actually here all the government building works are done by the public works department of the government. So in the public works department, Building Research Institute and Public Works Department lies under same Ministry of Housing and Public Works. So there was a good interaction between these two departments, and Public Works Department, they have accepted first the concept of ferrocement for their overhead water tank. Actually, at that time, the small building and rooftop water tank, there was a standard size of iron sheet, 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet cube. So 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet, and the water capacity is 400 gallons is the you see multiple of 444 and 400 gallon water. So that was very common in the market. And Building Research Institute, they started 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet rooftop water tank. And government department, public works department, they actually, all over the country, they have actually adopted that water tank concept. Later on, individual houses started to transfer in its apartment, condominium, and others. So it's a multi-story house. Then 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet water tank is no more. Actually, there was the water tank size becoming large. And the Research Institute, actually, they could not adopt themselves for large water tank because of lack of knowledge in the design of water tank. So they know only one size of water tank and the 12 millimeter thick wall and just single layer of wire mesh is enough for a small water tank. Now people are not using ferrocement water tank because water tank becomes larger and nobody actually practice for any shape of water tank here in Bangladesh. And during 80s, we started applying this ferrocement technology in the building floor also, floor and roof. The masonry wall, but floor for a four-story, six-story building, the wall is masonry, brick masonry, but floor is ferrocement panel. So in 84,
so is it a in-situ casting or a precast one?
It's a precast one.
Precast, okay.
Precast panel, yeah, precast panel. So one in two government building in 84. So we applied this ferrocement panel for floor, and architecturally there was a very small part in the kitchen. There was a different span. Because of that different span, actually they could not put the same module of ferrocement panel. So that part, actually they went for conventional concrete. So in 3 years back, actually I have visited that building, two buildings side by side. And the I have all pictures. The ferrocement roof is still as good as a new one, but the RCC part, actually the concrete quality was not good. They used to use the broken brick, clay brick chips for corseting. So because of that, poor quality concrete and brick chips, actually the reinforcement become rusted in the reinforced part of the slab. So now because of rusting of the reinforcement, actually concrete is spalling out and it become very risky. So now it requires replacement of RCC portion, but the ferrocement portion roof is okay.
I think this is also a nice idea to have the composite structures, a building instead of entirely in ferrocement, we can go for the walling with masonry or brickwork and the flooring and roofing by ferro cement. I think this is a very nice idea, Mr.
Milind. I have done one 5-story building and it's the beam column, foundation beam and column is normal RCC. Okay. And only all roof panels and walls are ferro cement. So,
any large buildings constructed in Bangladesh?
No, it's not very large. Actually, it's the concept. It's for rural model, very small unit, two apartment unit in one with stair. And stair for that 5-story building, whole stair is cast in situ ferrocement staircase. But other than stair, other elements in the slab are all precast. Actually, I want to take one opportunity. I am working right now with this ferrocement, but I am facing some problem. So maybe Professor Divekar and others, you can just help me. For very thin, actually, ferrocement member, so we are using the galvanized iron you mesh, and actually the in the market, the wire mesh we have is not properly galvanized, so it become actually rusted after if it is open. It cover because it's very difficult for a small section to maintain true part if it is, especially if it is precast. So now I am practicing the precast segment using the vibration table. So sometimes it is difficult actually to maintain the cover, and it start corrosion. So now I am practicing with the glass fiber mesh, which exactly same principle with ferrocement, but instead of wire mesh, I am practicing with a glass fiber mesh. So
okay.
My question is whether we can call it ferrocement or not, because the principle is the same, but the material is ferrous. So
then certainly it's ferrocement. I think Dr. Divekar, would you like to comment on this or his query?
Now the glass fibers which are used are having very short length, and their bonding is also very limited. In ferrocement, we use continuous meshes, and that is the main advantage. The bond length itself is hardly 3 or 4 millimeters, and then when we pull out that mesh, it won't come out at all. In the case of fiber reinforced, glass fiber reinforced, or any other fiber reinforced, the aspect ratio is very small, and it is that the bond which is effective is only useful for crack control. It won't increase much tensile strength. That is the disadvantage of fiber. Now, if you use ferrocement fibers, that will be only to control the crack width, further crack width. That is the only thing.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Divekar.
Just a minute. Can I say something?
Yes, yes, Sharmaji, please.
They have the problem of coating. They are getting, what meshes they are getting is a polished mesh, not the
galvanized. Not galvanized.
So there is a way out for that. You take all your rolls, put them in water for 3 days. Take it out, that entire coating will go. Then just beat them, and then the surface will be all right. And before using, you just use wire mesh over it, and then use it. Then your problem of corrosion will not come back.
This is a very simple solution and very good thing to do. You can try.
No, so it's better to use expanded metal wire mesh?
No, because expanded metal is cast iron.
Yeah.
Expanded metal is not mild steel. Okay. It is different, and it has got very poor tensile strength. Apart from this, another thing you can say, you know, hexagonal mesh and square mesh, the performance is very greatly different. If you use a square mesh, your structures are much more load bearing. When you use a hexagonal mesh, structures take less load. Because what happens in a square rectangle is hexagonal mesh, if you stretch it like this, this will expand. If you stretch it like this, this will expand. But this square mesh, both directions it will take load. So don't use the hexagonal mesh.
So you prepare the square mesh, yeah?
You must use this square mesh.
See, basically, as per theory, the ferrocement means the skeletal steel.
Regarding the problem with Mr. Sadeque is facing, I think he should refer to Dr. Naaman's book. There are two chapters exclusively dedicated to fiberglass and glass fiber reinforcement. And he has recommended the use of glass fiber reinforcement in ferrocement. It's a book on ferrocement, and he has given lot of curves and he has compared it with the steel reinforcement meshes, and he has given a comparison between the two. There is no problem in using fiberglass. It is ferrocement, and it is part of Dr. Naaman's book.
Okay, very good. We can have
and second point is,
yes,
second point is,
yes.
Mr. Sharma elaborated on. I have been using this wire mesh, steel wire mesh, which is available in the market openly, which is not hot dip galvanized, which is always Bombay polish, as we all call it. But I am not facing a problem because I have been using vibrators right from the beginning of my career, that is 1973-74, when I was exposed to ferrocement by Mr. P.C. Sharma. And because I have been using vibrations, the permeability of my structures is very low. The thickness of my structures is also very low. I mean, now at present, I am working with 8mm ferrocement, but I am not finding a problem of corrosion. With even 8mm total thickness, I am able to make structures which are 4 meters long. If I get some time, I will can elaborate on that, but that is not, this is not the time and platform.
Yes, certainly, Mr. Jain.
All your problems have a solution in Dr. Naaman's book. If I have 5 minutes, I would like to talk about something about the future of ferrocement rather than the past of ferrocement. We have already covered a lot, and we know what is ferrocement and what can be done with it and what cannot be done with it. It is very difficult to say what cannot be done with it, because I have done almost everything and everybody has done almost everything with ferrocement.
Yes,
but at present, I am working with 8mm thick plates with ferrocement, with 12 gauge 50 mm square welded mesh, with two 22 gauge chicken meshes on both sides, and 1:2 mortar. And I am making box sections out of it, which are 2 8mm plates separated by ribs of the same 8mm thickness, and I am making a box section, and we are in the we are using it for roofing, and we are in the process of developing a semi-automatic machine which will be producing about 10,000 square meters of this section per day, because that is the kind of requirement we have in the country at the moment. Because every government has to make, under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, a large number of houses which cannot be met with without the use of large-scale ferrocement construction.
Right. So the box section will be a precast only?
It will be a precast section.
That's why we can get the most.
I mean, I have all the pictures, all the slides, everything. But again, this is not the time and forum for that.
But certainly, would like to know from more details about that.
Maybe in the next session.
That
would be the future. Because I have designed a house of 12mm thickness. In 1 lakh, I am able to offer a house in total 1 lakh, excluding GST, of course, which is providing 400 square feet of floor area to the occupant. 400 square feet in 1 lakh rupee is not a small job. And we have already made the prototype, and we are in the process of popularizing it in the rural community. In the absence of the code, we have realized that we cannot go to the authorities, and we cannot talk to them, because they would just do not want to talk about ferrocement. But especially the rural people, those who have to live, if they save 50% of their money, they are ready to do it. They just have to see it and believe it. So we have made that prototype, and we are offering it to them in 1,400 square foot of floor area.
That is so these precast units would be useful only for housing purpose or maybe some other purposes?
I mean, we are making housing units for, precast units for all purposes.
Total design.
Total, even bridges, because I am a man who does not believe in theory, I believe in testing. So I have done all the
we
testing.
We know that. That's nice.
I have done all the testings. And I have shown it, I show it to people every time they come to my workshops. And when they see a load, it's carrying a load of 400 kg per square meter on 8 mm thickness, they are happy. They don't want more than that.
Yes, yes. We know seeing is only believing. So
right.
That is the principle.
Like I said in Kerala meeting that the bridges that we can make up to 10 meter span in 25 mm thickness folded plates, they carry easily 400 kg per square meter loading.
Yeah.
So they are just 25 mm thick and we can show the load tests, etc.
Yes, yes.
I don't believe in theories. I believe in actual testing.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Jain. You have shown a very bright and innovative future in this technology. Many other stalwarts are also trying and testing different ways of designs and different kinds of construction stalls.
Okay. I think personally, while, after I retired from AIT, I have not done any more research on ferrocement. But since 1970, when I started work on ferrocement, I believe that the material has tremendous applications, tremendous uses for it. And so we developed the International Ferrocement Information Center in order to spread the advantages of ferrocement. And unfortunately, in 2011, there was a severe flood that submerged the campus of the Asian Institute of Technology about 3 meters. And that flood lasted for more than a year, more than 3 months. And many of the books that I have collected all over the world on ferrocement were destroyed, which is a great pity. And so, it's a terrific loss of resources. Now, looking at the future, first I want to mention that the recent work of Professor Divekar, on cracking, because, when my own work in ferrocement stopped because I was promoted to become vice president, I couldn't teach anymore. When I stopped working on ferrocement, the last equation that I published was cracking. How can it crack? But unfortunately, I did not have time to follow it up by signing ferrocement after cracking.
Yeah, okay.
I think this is where Professor Divekar started his work. I'm sure he's done work before that, but this is, I consider this is one of the most useful developments in ferrocement because with the design equations that he has come up with, and the graph of all sorts, and the many examples that he has shown, I think gives designers a lot of confidence in designing whatever structure you can think of, even if that structure is going to be subjected to a severe load. So I see a very good future for a reverse, so to speak, of ferrocement. You know, if you want to call it ferrocrete, I don't care. But, you know, to me, it's still ferrocement. Now, the group in India is very strong now. And I'd like encourage you to work together and perhaps come up with your code of practice, because once you have that code of practice, I am quite sure that many countries will use it as a benchmark. So I really would like to encourage you know, you get together, continue this discussion and work, you know, every week, and work together and exert your collective influence on the authorities in New Delhi, you know, to approve the code of practice for ferrocement.
Yes,
pity that I stopped work on this in the 80s, but, you know, I couldn't help it. AIT needed somebody to look for millions, you know, all over the world. Mm-hmm. And so they said, please abandon your academic work and help us look for money for AIT. So that was what I did.
Yeah, no issue. Very good suggestion you have given, Mr. Pama. Basically, we have to do some research on that theory of cracking of the to get the good designs in ferrocement structures. Another is to create ISOs as early as possible. And of course, that is being done through such platforms by the society, by many other individuals. We will be following it up. We will be very soon submitting the draft code to the committee and for its approval. Thank you, Mr. Pama. I will invite now Mr. Milind Kulkarni. Has he rejoined?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes. You have 3 minutes. Please give your views on the future now. Let us forget about the past.
Yeah, that is why I'm extremely happy to see. I'm extremely happy to see all the stalwarts, and even at my age of 62, I look the youngest in the group, I think. So my only small mission is to join the help the team to bring out the code which will bring legitimacy to make it legitimate and legal for all the ferrocement contractors and ferrocement workers. So that they can do work legally and correctly. And second thing is bring up-to-date design engineering and drawings and calculations on par with what is done in RCC, so that we don't look inferior and we don't look something like, you know, it is a magic or something. People should respect our technology and people should understand and accept it, and eventually they should fall in love with this technology. So these are two things that are very important. And one small thing about the what Mohammad Sadiq said about corrosion, that is a very big issue, because the current RCC, IRC codes, prestige codes are going for durability criteria in a very big way. We are all aware of the environmental exposure conditions. So for us to make our code, it will be very challenging to have a 5mm cover and get away with it. So we will have to have chemical admixtures. And for this particular application, we have you know, cross-linking acrylic copolymers, which are basically alkaline passivators. We have to just dip the weld mesh in that and keep for some time and remove it. And that is a very long-term and a fantastic solution for corrosion prevention, because that will be needed when we are going to go for a cover of 5 and 7 millimeters, and to defend that will be very difficult in the current RCC thinking mode, where the cover is 40 mm, and where the cover is minimum 40 mm, and we have our 40 mm thicknesses which are very large for the section itself.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Milind. I think now we will have the views of Mr. Owen.
I think, of course, it has a great future with all these calculations. I still think it's the method of construction and the structure under the actual ferro cement should be something that's code conforming on its own. It'll help the ferro cement, the use of ferro cement, achieve more validity by using the rebar also as part of the structure. the calculations. That's all I have.
Owen, thank you very much for your views. Now, finally, in a nutshell, I will thank all the participants for giving their views openly, wholeheartedly. This is a very nice gathering today, where all ministers onwards have joined. And particularly, I thank Mr. Margarito, actually, who was to give today's presentation on his case study of a dam built in Ferrocement. But because of his, he could not be connected, we could get this opportunity to talk freely on our journey of Ferrocement technology worldwide. And we could interact together very nicely on the different aspects, right from the small components to big buildings, then different theories from cracking to the box type sections, the future, what Mr. Ashok Jain has told. Mr. Divekar is also developing one box type design for buildings, and so many innovative ideas are coming up. So for that, we will keep on interacting and taking this ferrocement technology ahead. So I thank you all for your participation.
Thank you very much.
Please don't forget to visit our website ferrocementindia.com. Please write to us on indiaferrocement@gmail.com. Thank you very much.